Thank you so much. Thank you, Greg, for the introduction. And this work has been primarily done by my student Daniel Schneider, on whose behalf I'll present this talk. So let me start with that introduction. So as you know, as device sizes shrink, we also the touch size of your displays get smaller and smaller, which potentially makes it hard for them for you to interact with them. And there's a whole research area which tries to address this problem, which is called around device interaction, and they basically try to extend the input space of your mobile device to the space around it. And there have been various techniques also in the session this morning. You've seen one approach. They typically either need to instrument the room, the environment, the device itself, or also the user in order to achieve those around device interaction schemes. So this is a common scheme, and you see it all over the place. Here are some recent work from this year's ISS and from ISS 2014, where you actually see how to extend the input space using external cameras. Early work by Butler et al., which equipped the mobile phone with additional sensors, or by Young et al. From WIST 2013, which used a 360-degree lens on top of the mobile phone, or our work from ISS last year, where we basically ask users to wear sunglasses in order to extend the input space of mobile devices. This is all good, but in fact, our goal is to enable around-device interaction on unmodified mobile phones, and we are also not the first to address this topic. There has been recent interest in enabling around-device interaction on unmodified mobile devices. There are basically two classes that I'm aware of. One is acoustic and inertial-based sensing, where you basically are trying to, using sound sources to relocate where a finger or an interaction device is on a surface next to the mobile phone. And the other one is computer vision-based sensing. Basically, here's a work of Ottmar Hilliger's group, also from Kai. And he actually tried to enable three-dimensional input using gestures on the back of the camera. A problem or challenge with this latter approach is that you still have a rather narrow interaction space, either on the back or on the front of the camera, basically in the viewing frustum of that camera. And you can't really use the side of the device. And to understand what we're trying to achieve, I have to take you back basically to last year to basically give you a short recap of what we did try to solve back then, right? So what we did is we used the front camera of a mobile device and basically looked onto reflections of a sunglass or a reflective visor that a user was wearing. And this enabled us to basically use the side of the mobile device's input space and to enable various various interaction techniques. So while this might work in certain situations, let's say on the ski slope or on working environments, it's not always appropriate to wear like super reflective visors, for example, in dark office environments. That's what I learned last year. And hence, we basically try to get rid of the sunglasses and take the next best thing behind the sunglasses, which are now the eyes, and basically to use eye reflections to enlarge the sensing area of the front camera. And if you look closely here, you have an inlay of a cornea. You can actually see a detected hand down here. But also, as you can imagine, this problem is much harder because the reflective area is so much smaller, it's more blurred, and it has non-uniform texture. And to address this problem, we basically looked at the area of corneal imaging or corneal reflective imaging, and we are also not the first who did this. There's actually a large body of work in that area. And corneal reflective imaging has been employed also in various domains. Here are just some sample domains to actually get calibration-free eye gaze tracking, so to get rid of geometric models for HMD or display calibration, or even for live logging. There have been at least proposals, not really systems, but proposals to use it for live logging purposes. But most of those systems actually rely on head-worn cameras either in built in into smart glasses or specifically head-worn eye trackers. And again, this boils down to equipping or instrumenting the users, which is something that we want to avoid. So the main research question that we are still trying to address, and we started to address here, is can a round device interaction become feasible on mobile devices if we use these corneal imaging techniques? And to make it a little bit more precise, what we want to do here is giving, let's say, an image of the front camera of your smartphone. We want to detect the eye, and in the eye we want to both detect a mobile phone, a smartphone, and an interaction device, in this case your hand. And then once we've detected them, we want to relate them together in a common coordinate frame, and if you know those relative positions, you can basically use it as an interaction device, a hand as an interaction device relative to your mobile phone. So here's the pipeline that we built to actually implement this. So we take the camera image and we pass it through some single steps, which I will explain to you in a moment, and then we could use it in an application scenario similar to the work that we presented last year. So let's start here. So let's say we take a camera image, and the first step is to actually know, is there an eye in the image or not, and where is the limbus? Just as a reminder, as an introduction, the limbus is basically the area between the white sclera, the outer part of the eye, and the iris and pupil region, which are formed together the cornea of the eye, and which are more suitable for actually detecting reflections. So we basic thresholding, contour detection, and ellipse fitting. We are basically following proposals of related work and get the area of interest in the input image that we want to process further. Then in a second step, we want to know where the eye is relative to our mobile phone or relative to the camera. And we use a very simple model, which is known from the literature, which basically assumes two intersected spheres of certain sizes and a weak perspective projection. And then if you know those sphere sizes or sphere diameters, you can relatively easy compute the pose of the eye to relative to the camera center. And once we have that eye pose, we can now unwrap the corneal image, right? That means we actually map it to a flat surface, similar as you would map a globe to a flat surface. In this case, using certain projections, actually a rectangular projection. And in this case, we basically just have to take care that we avoid, let's say, large distortions in certain areas of the eye, and hence we need to rotate that eye model a little bit. But the details for this are in the paper. And at this step, you have a low resolution, very blurry virtual camera image from your eye. This is what you have. And afterwards, you can basically apply any computer vision algorithm that you want to. And in our case, we basically want to detect the mobile phone and the finger. And this is what we do with very, very simple computer vision techniques. So nothing fancy here, simple marker detection, rectangle detection, and also hand detection, actually similar to what was shown before here. Right? So these are the basic vision algorithms that we apply here. So with this pipeline, at least in principle, you can detect and enable around device interaction. But the next question that really was very important to us to answer is what camera resolutions would we actually need to make this happen, right? We weren't so much concerned yet with robustness or real-world performance, but actually to see how long do we have to wait until we can use mobile devices to actually do these techniques or use these techniques. And towards this end, we conducted a user study where we wanted to know the localization accuracy between the smartphone and the finger under optimal conditions. We actually had two tasks, two conditions. I'm mainly concentrating on the more realistic one where we have a smartphone and we have a finger, but we have very optimized laboratory conditions, plain background, optimal lighting, and so on and so forth. And this is what you can see here. Right? So we had participants, 10 participants, who were positioned very carefully on a chin rest and a smartphone, and they had to put their finger in certain positions. I will tell you more about that in a second. And then, because we weren't sure on which resolutions we actually would need, we used a very, very high resolution imager and a macro lens to emulate high resolution future image systems, right? So we had a fancy SLR with 36 megapixels, 90 millimeter macro lens pointing directly at the face of the user, right? And this resulted then in a maximum eye resolution of approximately 1,000 by 1,000 pixels for that area. And this is what the users had to do. So we had our smartphone lying here, and then they had to tap, let's say, 9 locations a couple of times to actually, then take pictures to see if we can reconstruct the position of the phone and the finger. So, and here are the results, right? So, for the max resolution, you have a scatter plot here. The black squares are basically the ground truth positions where the user's fingers should be reconstructed, and the color-coded dots here are basically where the individual finger points were were detected, right? And you can see several things. So this is the max resolution, and then we halved the resolution, halved it, made it smaller, and you can see several things here. Unsurprisingly, the smaller the resolution, the more scattered the points are. That's not surprising. The second thing that you also might notice is that we have a certain skew here in that scatter plot. This is due to two facts. One, we used a standard eye model using fixed diameters, which doesn't fit the real user's eyes always. And second of all, we had an assumption that our mobile phone was lying parallel to the imaging plane, which is an assumption which is approximately true, but not always, right? As you see here, it's actually a little bit tilted, which also has an impact on these results. But anyways, this is what we did. And just to make you aware of these two scatter plots here, so this resolution would correspond to an ultra HD resolution on current mobile smartphones, and this on a quad HD resolution. This is basically what you can get using recent common mobile phones like the Samsung Galaxy S6, S7, S8 at a 30 centimeter distance. So this is basically would correspond to what you can get today, right? And this is another figure. Please concentrate here on the red, red plot, which basically gives you the root mean square error. And here you can say, if we would have that 36 megapixel high resolution imager, we could get a decent localization accuracy of, let's say, 6 centimeters. And if we take today's cameras, you could get, at least under this optimal condition, still get a resolution of about 10 centimeters, which isn't terribly good, but it's actually better than we expected when we started this research. So let me tell you some of the various limitations that we had. So what I wanted to stress again, we did a very controlled laboratory study here. So robustness in real-world backgrounds and lighting conditions and certain eye rotations haven't been considered yet. We also concentrated on a single eye, so we didn't use a stereo reconstruction approach, which we could do too, but we just didn't. And our pipeline wasn't optimized for video processing on mobile devices. We used a decent laptop with a dual-core system, and the algorithms took about 100 to 300 milliseconds to run, depending on the resolution. So in future work, we actually want to adjust our pipelines. We could, in fact, skip certain parts of the pipeline if we just wanted to use gestures. You don't need to know the eye pose. You don't need to know how the unwrapped image is if you just want to have relative motions. We want to implement it and evaluate on real-world mobile devices. And of course, as many of you too, we want to get our hands into deep learning and actually record the ground truth data set, also with an OptiTrack system, to see if somehow automagically a CNN can reconstruct relevant features for us to detect our mobile phone and our fingers. So with that, I want to conclude and just want to give you away these two key messages. So can around device interaction via corneal imaging become feasible? I would say yes, it could, but we only made a very brief and first step. Major challenges remain, and this is the most surprising result for me. For coarse input resolutions, you could start today using mobile phones that are in your pocket. So this brings me to the end of my talk, and just the last shameless plug, we are also hiring. So if you're a PhD student and want to pursue your research in augmented virtual reality or computer vision machine learning for HCI, please contact me. Thank you so much, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Yes, thank you. We've got time for a couple of questions. Anyone going? No, you're all quiet, the last talk. Oh, no. Go for it, Fabrice.
Yes, I agree with your conclusion. Obviously, if we're considering, especially the front cameras, which have a much lower resolution compared to the rear ones, I was thinking maybe you could just forego the just trying to tap a particular spot near the device, but you could just look at whether the user has a hand right or left of the phone, and you can do some very basic interaction with just the cardinal points.
Yes.
And then that probably you don't even need to do all that heavy processing.
So this is actually, I totally agree, and this is what I said here. For very simple interactions, you don't need the full pipeline. You basically need to know where the eye reflections and just see if you can detect the features that you want to and go from there. I totally agree, and this is what we are working on right now.
Okay. One more. Last question for the conference session.
Benjamin Wingert from University of Stuttgart. Great talk. Do you also restricted participants only with brown eyes or also bluish?
No, we have various iris textures here. So this is what we wanted to have. So we actually, I don't have a overview picture of all the iris textures that we had, but we actually had various iris textures here in our experiment.
Okay, so the contrast is then maybe not as good as some brownish eyes, but okay, great, thank you.
Cool. Let's thank Jens and all the speakers in the session.